had a tremendous service this morning, tremendous service last night, and I think we're going to have a tremendous service tonight. Amen. Praise the Lord. As everybody knows, Brother Gary Kincaid will be bringing the word. Super excited about that. So glad that him and Sister Allie were able to make the trip. Amen. And his birthday is coming up next week, right? Him and his twin brother has a birthday next week. So praise the Lord for that. Amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Yes, another year. Another year we get to be friends. Last year we got COVID together and thought we were going to die together. So praise the Lord. Listen, the Lord thought that we deserved another year together. Amen. So when he came down, his mom told him the only rule was that we couldn't get COVID together again. So we've been trying not to get COVID together this time. Amen. So I ain't getting COVID again. Can I get an amen? Praise the Lord. Amen. All right, everybody. Has anybody got any prayer requests tonight? We did get an update on Charity's grandmother. That she's off the ventilator now, and she was up walking today. Amen. Praise the Lord. Spirit God, whether it be a running and shouting or whether it be a sweet spirit, Father God, we thank you for loving us, God. We thank you for pouring out your spirit, God. Father God, for each and every one of these needs that were presented, God, if it's a healing need, God, Lord Jesus, I pray that your divine healing touch will go forth in the name of Jesus. Father God, for the teachers and the students of you, God, we pray that you'll touch them in the midst of this new school year. Father God, keep us praying, Lord, touch us parents, God, as we're maneuvering back into this school as well, God. Lord, right now, just begin to pray, God, that your will be done in this place, God. Touch every song sung, every singer, God, and every musician in the mighty and holy, matchless name of Jesus. And everybody said,
amen.
Amen. Amen. Brother Eddie and Sister Amy.
Thank you. to do, but you held on because who you were holding on to. Amen.
Hallelujah.
Sing that first verse again. I know we're going to move on to the preaching in a minute, but just sing that first verse again.
You ask me how it is that I'm still standing.
You ever felt like that before?
You wonder how I made through the storm. I can't boast of many special powers. That's a secret I just held on.
Spoke a word and it said steadfastness.
And I began to seek the Lord on your behalf, because I'm one of them people. I don't want to just come to a house of people without a word, without a rhema word from heaven, so you'll know what God wants for you to do and how God wants you to handle situations. But I want to know what the word of the Lord is for this hour and for this time. And I heard the word steadfastness, and the more that I began to seek the Lord, I heard the Lord speak to me the word constant. Everybody in their life needs a constant in their life. There's things on the outside that change, that you thought you could put your abilities in, or your securities in, but they begin to move on the outside. The things that you thought was going to be solid, sometimes they move out from under you, and life begins to take place, and you're looking for a rock. You're looking for that person. Some people will say in their family, well, this person was a rock. This person was the one that held us all together. You're looking for that person to put your trust in, that you can take refuge in when trouble and time happens, that it doesn't even look like what you planned or what you expected. But I'm telling you today that God wants you to be steadfast in Him, that He is the rock of our salvation. He is the rock. He is the constant, that no matter what's going on in the world, we can know that we can go to God. The word constant, if you would just simply define that, means occurring continually over a period of time. A situation or state of affairs that does not change. The Bible tells us in Hebrews chapter 13 that Jesus Christ the same yesterday, today, and forever. Hallelujah. He has a reputation of being the rock. He is the rock. He is the constant. And no matter when the winds come and the rains fall and they beat upon the house that Matthew chapter 7 talked about, because you're founded upon the rock, Jesus Christ, and no matter what comes at you to try to get you shaken, to get you off of the foundation of the rock of Jesus Christ, because of what you're founded upon, anything can come at you, because you're anchored in the rock of ages. Glory to God. He's the one that doesn't change over a period of time. He's the one that, even though circumstances on the outside and all kinds of things going wrong on the outside, I can stay steadfast. I can stay secure, knowing that I built my life upon Him, and He's given me a testimony that I know that He works, that I know that I can overcome the adversary by the word of God and by the blood of the Lamb. Praise the Lord.
Yes.
He's given us a testimony that we need to use, that we need to become steadfast, that we need to be constant. The scripture talked about it, we may get to it a little later, that we have the mind of Christ as believers. So if we begin to do what Jesus did, we begin to think the way Jesus did, because He is that constant. He said, upon this rock I'll build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. So since He is that rock, and since I have the mind of Christ, and you as a believer have the mind of Christ, if I begin to think, and I begin to do, and I begin to be a doer of the word of God, because James told us, if we're a doer of the word of God, the word will work for you and you work the word. But James said, if you're not a doer of the word and a hearer only, you're deceiving your own self. But I know that if I have the mind of Christ and I put into action those thoughts that He's already established in the word of God, that I can be a constant for other people when they're falling apart, when they don't know what to do, where to go, what should I say. They can come to me. I can lead them back to Jesus, because I am set on a rock. I am steadfast in Him. He has proven Himself over and over and over again. He is a constant, and I can be a constant for you. But there will be a time you may get a phone call that, even though one moment you were constant, sometimes the devil will throw some things at you, blindside you, And you're going to have to call on somebody that you know has been steadfast in the work of the Lord, in the word of the Lord. Somebody that's not just going to agree with the thoughts that you're having that's not from God, but they're going to correct you and get you reestablished on what you already know. Has anybody other than me had to make a phone call and let somebody tell you what you already know? Yeah, because I'm telling you, we need to be constant for people.
Amen.
I don't want you to put your trust in me, but I want to live a life before you and before God that if I don't know the answer at my home church, when the people come to me and they have questions, I told them, I said, listen, if I don't have the answer when you first come to me, I will find the answer. I will go dig in the word and get the answer, because Jesus said, I am the way, I am the truth, and I am the life. I can point you back to the constant that's in my life when I'm on the mountaintop. I can point you to the constant that was in my life when I was on the bottom. The psalmist said, though I make my bed in hell, though I went put my place when I'm in a spot where I'm constrained. That's what it's talking about. When you're hemmed in and you don't seem like you know a way out, if I made my bed in hell, behold, thou art there. So even on the mountaintop, we have security and knowing that we can feel the presence of God and know that He's there. But you've got to know that He is steadfast and He is a constant and He hasn't changed, whether you're in the valley, in the middle spot, whether you're on the mountain or you're at the bottom, He is the constant that will pull you back up on the top.
Yes, He will.
Hallelujah. So let me take you to my main scripture here. Hallelujah. 1 Corinthians 15 and 58 says, therefore, my beloved brethren, be ye steadfast, unmovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, for as much as you know that your labor is not in vain in the Lord. Let's talk about this verse a little bit. First off, he says, therefore, my beloved brethren, you must realize to be steadfast and to be putting your trust in the constant of Jesus Christ, the rock. You must realize, even when you don't feel like it, because we're not basing anything upon our feelings, we're not basing anything upon what it looks like on the outside naturally, but we know what God has said and what He has proven out in His word over and over. So you must realize, whether you feel like it or not, you are loved.
Amen.
You are loved. The little song that we teach the kids in children's churches, yes, Jesus loves me. It doesn't matter how old you get, there's going to be a time in your life that you won't need to hear that. Because the devil will lie to you and tell you, ain't nobody wants you. Nobody loves you. Look how you've been treated. Ain't nothing working out for you. But I want you to know that the devil is a liar. And he's the father of lies. He's the one that came up with it. So if you hear something from the devil, you go ahead and tell him, you're a liar, you're a thief, you're trying to steal, kill, and destroy me. Tell the devil, I know that I am loved of God. Therefore, I will stay with God no matter what my circumstance looks like. Amen. Regardless of people are patting me on the back, buying me extra gifts, treating me real good, or they're treating me like dirt, there is a one who created you that loves you.
Amen.
And he said, be steadfast. Well, what does that mean? I'm glad you asked. Steadfast in the Greek in this verse, it means tending to spend much time seated, that is immovable. So if I'm seated, then it's a done deal. I've done sat down. I'm resting in that thing. I'm not going to get up and move here and there and yonder. I'm seated. I'm steadfast in it, saying this is done. So when you're steadfast in something, you become rooted and grounded in that thing. And it says, unmovable. Once you're seated, you already know what you need to do. So it's not based upon what you see. It's based upon what you know of the Word of God. And only the Word that you know will make you free. You know, people misquote that and they say, it's the truth that will set you free. But that's not what it says. It's the truth that you know that will make you free. It's the truth that you have had revelation on, that this thing really works. It's that truth that I know, that I have knowledge in. That truth will make me free. When I apply it, and when I put it to use, even when I don't feel like it, that's when you need to use it the most. That's when you need to activate your faith and go ahead and stay seated. But I feel like moving because I prayed and I prayed and I prayed. And I thought I was in faith. Nothing's changed yet. I feel like moving because I don't feel like God's doing anything. But what are you to do? You stand on the Word. Stand on the rock. You stay seated on the very thoughts and the idea that I'm going to stay seated because I know what His Word said and I know what He spoke to me, and He will do it.
Amen.
He will perform this thing that He has started even under the day of Jesus Christ, according to Philippians 1 and 6. He'll do it. But we've got to stay seated. The moment that we get in fear, the moment that we get up and we begin to uproot ourselves, the Bible said that no man can pluck us out of His hand, but we can get up and walk out of His hand. We can get up out of His covering, out of His presence, out of His protection. But no man can do that. You have to do that yourself. I invite you to stay seated, to stay constant, to know that God is working, even when you don't feel Him working, even when you don't see Him working, even when you don't have friends acting wrong. Say it, go.
Yeah.
You've got this. Even when you don't have cheerleaders, even when you don't have a pep rally behind you, saying you've already won this, even before the game starts, I'm telling you, if God said you've won, then you've won. You keep your faith behind the One who is steadfast, that loves you. Glory to God.
Yeah.
Hallelujah.
Yeah.
So, you're loved, you stay steadfast, unmovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord.
Amen.
Number three, always abounding in the work of the Lord.
Yeah.
If you're having trouble staying in faith, then you need to go abound or have an abundance of working for the Lord.
Come on. Right.
Hallelujah. Now, this ain't Bible, but you've heard people say that idleness is the devil's workshop, sitting around doing nothing while the devil's feeding in lies to you and your soul and your mind.
Yeah.
Idleness is the devil's workshop. That's not a scripture. But there is a principle there that if we stay full of the Holy Ghost and stay full of the Word of God and abounding or going in abundance after the work of God, and we're trying to bring about His kingdom upon the earth, because he said in one scripture that the kingdom of God is within you. So if I keep my mind on Him, praise the Lord, and if I go after Him with everything that's in me, even though sometimes the things on the outside just ain't lining up, but I gotta know that I'm just gonna keep plugging. I'm gonna keep stepping. The Bible says we walk by faith and not by sight. The Bible says in another place that we live by faith. In another place, it talks about in Him, I live, I move, and I have my being. So I got to tell somebody today, if you might not have faith enough to get from the very beginning of point A all the way to point B, but do you have enough faith, the grain of a mustard seed that can move a mountain? Do you have enough faith to live for God today, this moment, this minute? Can you take the faith, which is the victory that overcomes the world? He has given us what it takes to get the victory. Do you have enough? Can you muster up enough just to get through the next 10 minutes. And then once you get past that 10 minutes, oh, you see that God has brought you through that testimony, that far. So how about the next 30 minutes? And you'll find out by the end of the day, you didn't only live by faith moment by moment, but you begin to step, and you begin to step one step, and you didn't even think you could get from one end to the other. But God wants to take you living by faith, walking one step at a time, and you're looking at it as a marathon, but God wants to take you one step at a time. And at the end of this thing, when you thought God wasn't even working, wasn't even moving, you stayed steadfast, you stayed living for God and walking faith out, you stayed walking step by step, and at the end of the thing, the Bible says the end of the thing, it's greater than the beginning thereof. The end of the thing. If you live by faith, you need to also walk by faith. One step at a time till you get there. And we don't have no room to uproot ourselves and become unstable. We need to stay seated in the Word of God, confident in Him. We need to stay constant. Remember, occurring continuously over a period of time. And then you can look back and say, look what the Lord has done.
Yeah.
Then you can look back and say, you know, I was living by faith moment by moment. I was stepping little bit at a time, little bit at a time. I didn't feel like running. I didn't feel like I had enough faith to run to get to the other side. But I took a step as God urged me to, as the Word of God urged me to. And then you get songs like, I just held on till the storm was over.
Yes.
What about if you get in the person's situation that the disciples was in, and this storm came up? Jesus was asleep in the bottom of the boat, in the hinder part of the boat on a pillow. He was resting. Storm wasn't bothering him. When you're in faith, you are in rest and you can sleep through the storm. God can give you rest in the middle of it. He stayed seated, hallelujah, because he knew who he was. And when you know who you are in Christ Jesus, then you can stand up and be a giant for the kingdom of God. You can stand up right in the face of adversity and say, I know the devil, you're presenting yourself, but I'm going to lean my hand to the plow. I'm not going to look back. I'm going forward in Jesus' name, hallelujah. So, abounding in the work of the Lord keeps your mind on things above. Colossians says to set your mind on things above. Set your affections, is what it says, on things that are above and not on the earth. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Glory to God. Let's go to Ephesians chapter 3, verse 17. It amazes me when I get under the anointing and start preaching and realize how many scriptures I cover that don't even are not even part of the notes. I'm not doing Brother John that well on purpose. It's the Holy Ghost.
Amen.
Ephesians 3:17. Let Christ may dwell in your hearts by faith. How's he dwell there?
By faith.
By faith, so you ain't got no time to get up off of it and leave God, right? So he dwells in your heart by faith, and ye being rooted and grounded in love. You're not going to get rooted unless you stay hooked up by faith. Psalms chapter 1 talked about it, that you're planted by the rivers of water, and you will you'll bear your fruit in your season. I'm paraphrasing, but it's in there. That you'll bear your fruit in your season, but we get tired of waiting for our season, and so many people will just want to get up, give up, give up on God, even though they had a word.
Come on.
Hold on to the word.
Yeah.
Through faith and patience,
hallelujah,
it'll be established.
Right.
So when we stay hooked up to the river, then we become rooted and grounded, and we're established, and we can stay there. But we've got to make that choice. God don't make that choice for us. He wants us to make that choice. He presents it. It's up to us. In Psalms 40, verse 2, He brought me up also out of a horrible pit, out of the miry clay or the contaminated clay, and set my feet upon a rock and established my goings. When I didn't know which way to go, knowing that the way that I was going without the Lord was wrong. There's a scripture that talks about that the men did what was right in their own eyes, not what God wanted them to do, but they went without God and they done what was right in their own eyes, which is wrong. You need God. You need Him to establish your goals. But once He tells you and shows you this is what you need to do, this is the direction that you need to go, don't put a time limit on God. Do you know that time is not in eternity? So since time is not in eternity, then God is not bothered by time. And once He gives a word, He doesn't put a time limit upon it. He just said, if I told you I would do it, then you put your faith behind me and you just keep believing. You keep confessing my word, knowing that I'm not a man that I should lie or cry, but know that I will do that very thing. So we put time on it. The devil uses time against us in this realm, but there is no time limit in the heavenly realm. Hallelujah. So once He establishes your goals, you stay on that path.
Amen.
You learn His ways. Teach me your ways, O Lord.
Amen.
Glory to God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Let's go to James chapter 1, verse 6. But let him ask in faith, nothing wavering, for he that wavereth is like a wave of the sea, driven with the wind and tossed. For let not that man think that he shall receive anything of the Lord. And verse 8 says, a double-minded man is unstable in all of his ways.
Amen.
So we have got to realize that we're going to be presented with opportunities to let things come into our soul. The fiery darts are thoughts from the enemy. Thoughts to trying to get you talked out of what God is trying to get you talked into. And the reason I say God's trying to get you talked into it is you've heard people, and you'll know this is the truth. You can get up in the morning and you can confess out of your mouth, I'm going to have a bad day. Oh my goodness, I've got so much to do today. It's going to be such a bad day. And what about that person always gives me a hard time? I'm going to have such a bad day. And your confession and your faith behind that negative confession brought you a bad day. But when I get up and I know that God's given me a word and I'm just waiting for it to come to pass, hallelujah, it's just a matter of when my faith gets connected with God's word and He brings it to pass and His timing is perfect and I know that He hasn't dropped me, He hasn't forgot me, He hasn't given up on me, but He has a plan for me. The Bible said in Jeremiah that His thoughts toward me are peace and not of evil, to give me an expected end. All this verse excites me. Jeremiah 29:11. To give me an expected end. Who's expected end? It's the end that God had already preordained for me if I would stay in His will, if I would live by faith and walk by faith and not give up and stay steadfast and stay constant and not listen to people trying to pass out. If I don't listen to the lies of the devil coming through my mind, then he'll try to use circumstances. He'll try to use people to bring it through them. But I'm telling you, if it's not something God would say, if it's not something His word would back up, then you throw it away. You don't allow the devil or somebody else being used to the devil to talk you in to aborting the mission for you to give up on your promise that you'll believe in God for. And you see what I'm telling you? I'm believing God for a healing that God's already given me. I receive it in Jesus' name. But it's been 44 years. I've had the opportunity to give up, to get up and say, I'll just go on without it. But I have a promise from my Father that He said I could have it. And another scripture in your ear, to give you a phone call, to give you a text, to give you a message. I just want to tell you, I don't know why I need to tell you this, but the Lord woke me up at 3 o'clock in the morning to tell you this text, that He really loves you, not to give up. Hallelujah. Because we may not know in the natural what God has told you. I don't go to church here. I don't know what God's told you, but I do know that He sent me with a word from God to tell you that the devil is going to give you opportunities to give up and to give in and to quit. And God says, stay established in me. I am your constant. I will never leave you nor forsake you. I will be with you even unto the end of the world, the end of the age. He is a faithful God, and He will bring it through for you. But you must stay rooted, grounded in love. Love will keep you grounded. And God is love. And there's no fear in love, according to 1 John 4. And if there's no fear in love, then I know that God is love. And it's just a matter of God's will connecting with my faith. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. There's four things that believers must do to continue standing and steadfast. If any of you keep notes, please write these down. Number one, to stay steadfast, rooted deeply in love. You must submit to God. Number one, you must submit or yield to God to stay steadfast. The moment that you quit submitting to God, then you are in rebellion. You're not listening to God, nor letting His will come to pass in your life. You must submit to God. James 4 and 7 says, submit yourself therefore to God. Once you yield the battle over to God, resist the devil and he will flee from you. But see, that's why the devil don't want you submitting to God, because he wants you to just go ahead and give up and quit. Because he knows if you submit to God and then you resist the devil, or you stand against the devil, you oppose the devil, you resist him. When you do that after yielding to God, he has to flee. He doesn't want to flee. He wants to make progress in your life to get you unrooted. Number two, which I've uncovered it, you must resist the devil, but go ahead and write that down. Number one, you must submit to God. Number two, you must resist the devil. So submitting to God and saying, God, I want you to do your work, that's not enough. Praying to God and inviting Him into the situation to move is very important. That's what prayer is for. We're not to resist the devil and rebuke the devil in prayer, because we're praying to God. We're not praying to the devil. In prayer, we are welcoming God in the situation and asking Him for His help. But that in itself is not going to get it done, because God has given you the authority that He gave Jesus.
Yes.
So we have got to get up and use that authority and resist the devil. I thought about, and I'll be back to these in just a minute, when the disciples was in the ship, you know, and the storm and the waves was coming in the boat, about to overtake the boat, and then they say, Master, carest thou not that we perish? And of course He cared. He was in faith, though they wasn't. And so, you know, there's times in life that you're going somewhere and you feel good about it, and then a storm happens. What I'm talking to you about today, and what I was sent to Lawrenceburg, Tennessee, is to tell you that the opportunity for you to say, Jesus is in my boat, why ain't He doing anything? He's asleep. There's times that we feel that way. God, I've served you so long, and I've asked you to move, and it seems like nothing's happening. And then I go to look for you. They went to look for him and he was asleep. When you get to these moments, I want you to know that Jesus was asleep in faith because he said, let us go to the other side. So he knew that they were going to the other side. He didn't say that you wouldn't encounter a storm on the way. So he was already in a rest, knowing that the word of God had already went forth, that we're going to the other side. So even if it doesn't feel like God's moving at all, he's moving even though you can't see it. He's working for you. And don't let, because again, we put timeline on it, God. And then we'll turn a request for God's help into a begging session, and we'll call it prayer. And we're not to beg God. Beggars are not believers. Beggars are in doubt and unbelief. When you're in faith, you already know what's about to happen because you've submitted the situation to God. You've resisted the devil. You've asked for God's help. But don't expect God to do what he gave you the authority to do yourself. I'm going to say that again, because that's important. Don't expect God to do for you what God gave you the authority to do yourself.
Amen.
We've got to use the name of Jesus and the authority that we've been given. Number three, you must get around people of the same spirit of faith. Having the same spirit of faith or the same faith attitude, they're believing the same word that God has given you, or the same word that's connected to the Logos, written word of God. These people, and you're not going to find very few of these, but these people are the people who want to see you prosper, who want to see you get the promise of God, who want to see you baby healed, who want to see you get a better job, who want to see you whatever God's told you, and they are connecting with you on purpose through faith, through what God's told you in your spirit, connected to what's on the written pages of God's word, and they are believing God with you, to where when you're around those people, you need to get around those people more often, hallelujah. Because I'm not going to tell you that the devil's going to stop attacking, but I want to tell you something. If the devil's not going to stop attacking, then I'm not going to stop yielding to God, casting my cares upon him, for he cares for me. And when I roll it over on God, and I put my faith behind God and his word, I can say, seek him, Jesus. Maybe I shouldn't say it that way because I don't want to be dishonorable to the Lord, but I know that he will go fight for me because it's not my battle, but it's his. Now when I try in my flesh to bring about in the natural something that's spiritual without going through prayer and without going through faith, all you're going to do is get out aggravated and frustrated. But I can get in faith and I can get in rest, knowing that God is for me and not against me. That I can do all things through Christ that strengthens me. And without him I can do nothing. So you must get around people of the same spirit of faith, having the same attitude, believing the same thing that you are. 2 Corinthians 4:13 says, we have in the same spirit of faith according as it is written, I believe, that's key. I believed and therefore have I spoken. You will speak what you believe. Now I pray that it is the word of God that you believe. But if you've been talked into believing a lie from the devil, you will still speak what you believe. So make sure that what you're speaking and what you're believing is something that's going to bring about the promise of God in your life. And number four, you must feed on the truth of the report of the Lord. You must feed on the truth of the report of the Lord. When you do those four things, it causes something to happen as he brings you through. Because I don't know if you've noticed this, the longer you've been a Christian, you can look at something as one big old long victory. But I prefer to break it up into little segments to where, well, he done that part. So let's celebrate that part of the victory. And when you begin to celebrate that part of the victory, when you begin to have a Holy Ghost party all by yourself, when people don't understand why in the world's he in the bathroom so long. Because after I done my business, me and the Lord, we had some business to take care of. He began to speak something to me, and I began to give glory to God because I began to celebrate little victories. Hallelujah. Little victories will get you to big victories. And at the end of it, you're saying, how did I get here? At the end of this thing, look how good the Lord has been to me. He must really love me. And you got to receive all of that because you stayed steadfast and constant, doing the work of the Lord, fulfilling in your own life the mind of Christ, little by little. Stop looking at it as this big old task that I got to get through. Oh, I got to. I have to look at these tasks that look insurmountable sometimes. The Bible says, with men, this is impossible, but with God, all things are possible. So, since I really believe that, I will go ahead and stay seated. I'm knowing that he's got it under control, that there's nothing more that I can do but to take it to him, stay in the word, and submit to him and resist the devil and watch him flee. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Let's go to 1 Timothy 6 and 12. It says, fight the good fight of faith. Lay hold on eternal life whereunto thou art called and hast professed a good profession before many witnesses. You can also say the word professed is confessed. Again, going back to what you speak. So fight the good fight of faith, laying hold on eternal life. What in the world does it even mean to fight the good fight of faith? The devil is after your faith. So the fight is to keep your faith. Since we know that without faith it is impossible to please God, that they that come to him must first believe that he is, and that he is a rewarder of them that diligently seek him. Diligently seek him. Constantly seek him. He is a rewarder. He didn't say, now if they seek me over a certain amount of time, then I'm a diligent rewarder. No. Those that diligently seek him. Examples of people who are constant, steadfast, not moved by their circumstance, not moved by what they see, not moved by what they tried to make happen. Daniel chapter 6 verse 10, it talked about it, that he prayed before the Lord, opening his window toward Jerusalem, prayed three times a day, and then the people come up to him and said to the king, has issued this decree that if you pray or bow before any king other than him, that you're going to be thrown into the lion's den. Now somebody that wasn't steadfast, somebody that wasn't constant would say, oh, fear would hit their heart. Oh, I can't pray. They're going to see what I'm doing. But somebody that's steadfast and knows the value of being rooted and grounded in the love of God and the word of God cannot be persuaded any other way. So he opened his window the same way he'd been doing before time and still prayed three times a day. I'm looking for some people in this house who will fight the good fight of faith, who's not going to give up on their faith. I don't know what you're going to face. I didn't come with a negative word, but I'm going to tell you that, look, I'm a pastor at heart. That's what I'm called to do. So I come with not an evangelical message, but I come to tell you a pastoral message that I love you. And I want to see you succeed. I want to see you grab a hold and get what God's got for you. So in order to do that, you're going to have to stay steadfast. You're going to have to stay constant on what you already know. And believe me, there's going to be opportunities that you're going to have. Should I go ahead and give this up? thing the devil uses is lie. You didn't hear from God to start with, or it would have already happened.
Mom. Yeah.
It's a lie. God is faithful. And I'm telling you today that sometimes we formulate in our own mind, I'm just about done, hang with me just a few more minutes. We formulate in our own mind, I don't know why we do this in the flesh, but every one of us do it, of how we think God's going to do something. And when it doesn't come through the way that we think God's going to do it, oh, I must have missed God. And then we begin to get little by little unseated and unrooted. And some people get backslid if they don't get from God exactly what they wanted when they thought they should get it.
Yeah.
Can I give you an example without getting too political? The best example I can give you about this was, I still believe that God is moving in this election, that we've, this fraud election that we've just encountered in the U.S. And God's uncovering some things, and His will be done. How do I know that? Because He said in the latter days that there was going to be an outpouring of His Spirit.
Amen.
And we haven't quite seen all of that yet, so I know He's not done.
Amen.
Okay? So, but how many people in faith, church people, really thought by January the 6th, Inauguration Day, that God was really going to move on that day? And because God's not moved by time, He didn't move on that day the way that we thought that He should, that we could see. So many people lost their faith in that. So many put their faith in a date and a time of what they thought should happen. But God hasn't let go of it yet. But He didn't base it upon that date and that time. You think that's an important day? Normally it would be. But there's getting ready to be a bigger date called the outpouring of the Holy Ghost when the former and the latter rain come together in the same month, according to the Scripture. It's going to be a bigger day. So people need to hold on to their faith. Stay steadfast. Stay constant to know that God is still moving. Hallelujah. I just use that as an example. When you look at Job, because I gave you Daniel as an example. When you look at Job, and he lost all that he had, and in the very end, he got double, but it took some time to get to the end before he would get to the devil. But in the middle of it, in Job 1:22, he said, "In all this, Job sinned not, nor charged God foolishly." What if he would have in the middle? Would he have got the double at the end? See, this was the oldest ancient character in the Bible that didn't have a full revelation of who God was, but he had enough sense to know, don't sin against God or say something stupid against Him.
Amen.
Even though I don't understand the situation, I don't understand why I got these bulls when I've been faithful, when I'm sitting here with this piece of pottery scraping these bulls, and I got some friends that don't know how to talk faith, and they're trying to tell me that I've sinned and I've done this and that, but He stayed faithful, and He stayed a hold of God. Maybe He didn't always want to. It didn't say that, but it did say that He sinned not and charged God foolishly. So in the season, Lord Abba Shaka, in the season when you don't know what to say and you don't understand, because we're all going to go through these seasons eventually, when you've done your best to stay in faith and you'll go through a season like Job went through, God, I don't understand, but I'm not going to say something stupid or sin against You, because I know You're faithful, and I know You ain't forgotten me. And at the end of that, Job got double. Is it worth staying seated? You need to set your face like a flint. One day I thought about that statement of setting my face like a flint. What's that mean? Well, through study, I realized that flint's one of the hardest rocks there is. You're not going to change it very easily. So before you get in this situation of, God, I don't know what you're doing, you need to make up your mind based out of what you've heard in your spirit. Make your mind up before you get there that I ain't leaving you, God. You've been too faithful to me. I'm not leaving you. I'm going to trust you all the way through. I'm going to trust you all the way through the fiery furnace. If the three Hebrews that hadn't trusted God and had faith in God, they would have burned up in that fiery furnace. They said, but I know our God is able to deliver us. But even if he don't, we're not going to bow to you. That's some faith that's steadfast. And because of that, I'm not going to say you're not going to walk through some fire, but I will tell you that Jesus will be there. I will tell you that the smell of smoke won't even be on you at the end of it. I will tell you that because you stuck it out and you went through step by step, living by faith, walking by faith, not by sight, because don't be led by your sight. Your sight will lead you straight into doubt and unbelief and talk you out of what God's got for you. You cannot put any trust, no confidence in your sight. You put your confidence in God. You make up your mind before you get there. If this happens, then this is what I'm going to do. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Glory to God. I have one more thing I need to tell you. As being led to the Lord, this is important. Somebody posted this on Facebook. Glory to God. You enable or disable the storm by how you live and what you build on. You enable, in other words, you give it access and ability. You enable it or you disable it, the storm, by how you live and what you're building on. So if you're building on the rock, Jesus Christ, and all the winds blow and the rains come and fall upon the house, but it didn't move you because you was built upon the rock, the constant. But if you're built upon the sand, the same storm can come, and great was the fall of it, Matthew said. Maybe there needs to be a foundation test. See, one of the main things you can learn about what kind of foundation you're on is how easy do you give up when opposition shows up? How easy do you give up when affliction shows up? How easy do you give up when the report doesn't line up with what you want to hear, but you still believe the report of the Lord? I came tonight with a word. Hear me. I came tonight with a word ahead of time. God was gracious enough to send me ahead of time to tell you, stand now. Be steadfast now. So when you have that season that nobody wants, you're not going to be moved. Yeah, you might get some rain on you. You might feel the wind. But if you're anchored in Jesus and you decide today, when things are good, I ain't moving. When the Lord first gave me this message, I looked and looked for a picture that I could use as a title screen, and I couldn't find nothing decent enough that I would bring into the house of God. It reminded me of these wrestlers that have these rock hard abs, and man, they would take a punch in the abs and they wouldn't flinch. That's what I saw in the spirit when the Lord gave me this message, that yeah, you might get hit, but if you prepare ahead of time, you're not going to flinch.
Amen.
It's going to hurt the enemy, the fact that he even tried to hit you, because our God is faithful, and this is not the first round that he's ever won. He's never lost a battle, and he's going to win yours. But you're in a preparation time right now. This is the time that you've got to make the decision. I don't know what tomorrow holds, but I know who holds tomorrow. And I'm going to hold on to him no matter what happens. You see, if there was one thing, and don't force it, but if there was one thing that would get you to give up and backslide, if there was one thing, if you voiced it, the devil would try his best to create that situation. So you need to determine in your heart, there's nothing, nothing that's going to separate me from the love of God. Nothing. It's made me more than a conqueror through Christ Jesus. So no matter what comes at me, even if it don't work the way that I planned it, I know it's going to work the way God planned it, and we're going to come out on top. Is Alicia still here? I need you to sing Held On. We're going to come back into that. That was prophetic tonight. Now what I'm going to do, because I believe everybody in this house is saved. If you're not, you need Jesus. And you don't have a constant if you don't have Jesus, because the devil will drop you. He'll act like that he's been, oh, he's for you. But he'll drop you in a heartbeat. You need the Lord. But as we bow our heads tonight and we begin to pray before the Lord, with his grace, his strength is made perfect. Father, I pray in the name of Jesus that you sweep over Unity Church of God. God, I pray, God, for strength. Going to go through great battles, but because you stayed in faith, it's just going to feel like a hiccup, a bump in the road. Because you prepared, and then you didn't let the report of the enemy affect you. You didn't flinch. You didn't ask for the fight, but you're going to win it anyway. When I was at school, Dad always told us, he said, son, don't you start a fight. But if someone starts a fight, you make sure you finish it. I'm telling you today that if the Lord's going to pick a fight with you, then God has armed you, that you're going to win, and you can be more than a conqueror. You didn't ask for it, but if he's going to pick a fight, you finish it with the authority of Jesus' name. And you win. Father, strengthen your people. Father, you know ahead of time more than I know about this. But God, undergird them. Hold them up. Protect them, God. Just like Aaron and Hur held up Moses' hands, and as long as his hands was up, they was winning the battle. Shut up and hear me. As Pastor John and Charity go through this situation with their precious son Micah, you hold their hands up. You love them. You be right there, because God is faithful. And because God is faithful, I want you to be there. I will be there through my prayers and my love. But you be there. And you show them through your faithfulness just how faithful God is. And at the end of this day, you'll see the victory come about sevenfold. You in Jesus' name. Now, I don't believe that's the only issue, but I know that that's one of them. I don't know in everyone in your lives what's going to happen or how it's going to happen, but I do know if you hold on to Jesus, there's only one outcome. If you turn loose of Jesus, there's only one outcome. Some of you may have not had a constant in your life, but now you have Jesus. He's there. Lean into Him. When you need a hug, when you need love, when you need someone to pick you up, Jesus will hold you. You might think I'm crazy, but I went through a time in my life years ago that nobody that I loved was around me for a season. And I grabbed my Bible, put it on my chest, and hugged it as tight as I could because I knew it was the Word. And I knew that He loved me. And I knew that He had my back. And I knew that He would bring me through. And you're not alone. Even when your eyes don't see nobody else, you're not alone. He's with you all the way. So my brother, he said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. Stop trying to figure it out on your own. Lean on me. Anchor yourself in me, said the Lord. So you think you're anchored, but go deeper, deeper, deeper. You're going to need it. Raise your hands. says in the Amplified Classic Bible, John 16:7, "Howbeit I am telling you nothing but the truth when I say it is profitable, good, expedient, advantageous for you that I go away. Because if I do not go away, the Counselor, the Helper," talking about the Holy Spirit, listen to all this, "the Comforter, the Counselor, the Helper, the Advocate, the Intercessor, the Strengthener, and the Standby will not come to you." I'm going to go through that list again, because this is your help coming to you that lives inside of you as a believer. The Comforter, the Counselor, the Helper, the Advocate, the Intercessor, the Strengthener, the Standby. He's inside of you to get you through. And you got the Word of God coupled with that. That's how you stay steadfast and constant. That's how you win. Church, I love you. And I know God's about to do something big. So stick it out. Stay strong for the tough spots. They don't last forever. And the good is coming out of it. The greater. Praise God. Thank you for having me this morning. Pastor.
Come on, say this one more time. We're going to leave.
Next week, do what you have to do in your name and pray. Amen.